Hi, this is Dr. Frank Schallenberger. I've been practicing medicine since 1973, and today I'm going to want to talk to you about what you should eat. You hear a lot of talk these days about two different sorts of extremes from a dietary perspective. One is you hear everybody or a lot of people saying that, you know, the best diet is one that's very high in complex carbohydrates and very low in fat. On the other end of the extreme, you hear other experts saying, no, actually the best diet is one that's very low in carbohydrate and very high in fat. And so who's right? How do you know what you should do? That's going to be the subject of what I'm talking about today. Now, one person that addressed with this issue many, many years ago was the most famous physician of all time. His name is Hippocrates, and he came up with this brilliant statement that you see here on the screen. One man's food is another man's poison. It's pretty obvious when you stop and think about it, but it needs to be said again. There is no one diet out there, whether it's a high carbohydrate diet or a low carbohydrate diet or whatever it is. There isn't any one diet out there that's going to fit everybody. As Hippocrates said, a diet that's going to be great for this person over here is actually going to be a poison to this person over here. So we're going to talk about this carbohydrate fat thing, and I'm going to give you some information to help you try and figure out what's the diet that's best for you. So how can you tell if your body prefers carbohydrates or fats, and what's that all about anyhow? Well, first, to understand this, you have to understand metabolism. Metabolism is that term that we use that describes how human beings make energy, how we get energy. We get the energy from oxygen, and we get that energy by either the oxygen burns fat or it burns carbohydrate. Now, for purposes of what we're going to talk about here, I can also use the term glucose for carbohydrate, because ultimately all the carbohydrates that you eat, they ultimately break down into glucose anyway. And by the way, when I'm talking about carbohydrate, I'm talking primarily about fruits, sugars, grains like corn and wheat and rice and such, and root vegetables, such as carrots and beets and potatoes, and finally legumes. Those are your main carbohydrate foods. So for some people, their bodies are going to prefer they eat a lot of those foods, and for other people, eating those foods isn't such a good thing. It could be in fact act like a poison to the metabolism. So what happens is your metabolism uses these either fat or carbohydrate to produce energy. Now, one type of person is a person who has a metabolism that prefers to burn carbohydrates for energy, and the other person is a person that prefers to burn fat for energy, and that's going to make a big difference on what type you are in terms of what you eat. So let's get into a little bit more here. We'll talk about the mitochondria, because those are the little elements in your cells that where all the metabolism happens. You're roughly speaking, almost half of your cell, mass is mitochondria. So this is a very important thing. This is where all the energy is produced in your cells, so that your cells can do all the things that they have to do and you can function well. So the power engines of the body, and more than anything else, your mitochondrial function is going to determine your overall health. If you have great mitochondrial function, odds are you're going to live a long, healthy, very productive life. If you have poor mitochondrial function, odds are you're not going to be that way. So here's how it works. Carbohydrates in some people improve mitochondrial function. These are the people that are primarily carbohydrate burners. Those are the people that want to eat a lot of carbohydrates. On the other hand, in other people, eating carbohydrates actually suppresses mitochondrial function. This is true to the extent that when I test mitochondrial function of my patients, if they're one of those people and I give them, let's say, a cookie to eat or a piece of bread or something, the mitochondrial function will completely decrease rather dramatically almost immediately. Those people would be the primary fat burners. So on the one hand, your primary fat burner cannot tolerate carbohydrates because it's going to suppress mitochondria. On the other hand, primary carbohydrate burners do just great with carbohydrates. So which are you and how can you tell? Well, one of the ways you can tell is just by your basic genetic makeup. People who are primary carbohydrate burners tend to be thin, the ectomorphic types, the people that engage and do well in long-distance sorts of endurance events, such as triathletes and marathon runners and such. They're also, the classic carb burner can't hardly gain weight. They tend to be skinny, and they can't gain weight. So if you're in that camp, you're probably a carb burner. On the other hand, fat burners tend to be more muscular. They have more mesomorphic type of body builds, also endomorphic body builds. They're very good at power sports, short distance events, and they often have a lot of trouble losing weight, maintaining a decent weight. So those would be the two genetic extremes. And of course, everybody else kind of fits somewhere in between these extremes. Another way to kind of have a sense for whether your body prefers to eat carbohydrates over fats or vice versa is your exercise schedule. If you have a very intense exercise schedule where you spend, 5-10 hours a week exercising, your body's going to primarily want more carbs. Your body's going to shift more into a carb-burning metabolism. If, on the other hand, you don't exercise at all, or you exercise just minimally just to kind of get by, your body's going to shift more into a fat-burning mode. So looking at your genetics, looking at your exercise schedule, start to give you a little bit of an idea of what you should feed that body of yours to be healthy. The last factor is your age, the amount of birthdays you've had. If you've had a lot of birthdays, your body's going to shift more over into a fat-burning mode. On the other hand, if you're young, most young people, certainly below the age of 30, are typically primary carb burners. Now, all that changes as you get older. So you could be a primary carb burner when you're 30, and by the time you're 45, you've now shifted over to being a primary fat burner. So you look at these three factors, and that'll give you an idea. But there's actually a better way to determine this, one that's more scientific. And in order to understand that, I want you to look at some diagrams here. Here's a diagram of a primary fat burner. Now, what the red circle represents is a mitochondria. Keep in mind, you've got thousands of mitochondria in your cells. I'm just showing you one for purposes of the explanation. But what happens in this mitochondria is all that oxygen you're breathing, that's where it's headed. That's where it's going. It's going to go in your mitochondria. And in this fat-burning model, so this is a model of a person who's a primary fat burner, all the fat in his body is going to get broken down, and it gets burned in the mitochondria. It doesn't get burned anyplace else. If it's not getting burned in the mitochondria in a fat burner, it's not going to get burned. Now, fat burners can also burn glucose, so we've got glucose over here. But my point is, fat burners have to burn fat in the mitochondria. If they don't, they're not going to burn the fat, which means they're going to start accumulating fat. Okay? Now, here's what a carb burner looks like. It's a different sort of model. Notice that the carb burner does not burn fat in the mitochondria. The carb burner burns fat, but not directly, not in the mitochondria. What the carb burner does is the carb burner is very effective at this process called gluconeogenesis. Gluconeogenesis is a term that's used to describe how the liver can convert fat into glucose. So in the carb burner, person who's a primary carb burner, they do not break their fat down, send it to the mitochondria and burn it down here. They do this. They take their fat, break it down, send it to the liver, and the liver actually converts it to glucose. It's interesting because you realize from this that your body actually makes glucose. And that's why, by the way, you don't really need to eat carbs. They're not essential to your health because your body can actually make the glucose that the carbs produce. So it's, nobody would want to do this, but let's just say somebody went out and for the next 2 weeks, all they ever ate was butter, pure fat. No carbohydrates at all. What would their blood glucose level be? It'd be totally normal because they're going to convert fat via this process of gluconeogenesis into glucose. And that's the nature of a carb burner. If you look down here in the carb burner's mitochondria, he's only burning glucose. He's only burning glucose. All his fat gets converted to glucose and he lives off glucose. That's why he's a primary carb burner. He wants to eat a lot of carbs because they supply the glucose, and this is the way he lives. He doesn't burn fat efficiently down here. He only burns glucose efficiently, so he needs to eat carbs. So on the one hand, you got this fat burner who burns his fat down here, and on the other hand, you've got a primary carb burner who doesn't burn fat down here at all. He only burns glucose down here. So depending on which one you are, that's going to determine what you primarily ought to eat. Now, there's a good scientific way to determine what your type is. And that is by looking at what's called your RER ratio. That stands for respiratory equivalency ratio. The RER ratio is the ratio of carbon dioxide being produced compared to the amount of oxygen being consumed. Okay, and the reason this is important, because carbohydrates, when you're a carb burner, for every molecule of oxygen that you're consuming, you're going to produce more carbon dioxide than you would if you were burning fat. And I'm going to show you this with a graph here in a second. So basically, just remember this, that a ratio, an RER ratio that's close to one indicates that you're primarily a carb burner, whereas a ratio close to 0.7 indicates that you're primarily a fat burner. So here's a graph that kind of shows that. So if you look down here, it'll say the amount of carbohydrate that's burned in a mitochondria. That's what this is referring to. So if you go down here where there's no carbohydrate being burned in a mitochondria, just all fat, you have an RER ratio of 0.7. On the other hand, as you're burning more and more carbohydrate in the mitochondria, let's say over here, the mitochondria are doing nothing but burning 100% carbohydrate, the graph goes all the way up here, and the ratio becomes 1. So by looking at this ratio, you can determine whether you're primarily a fat burner, primary carbohydrate burner. Notice right in the middle here at 0.85, that's kind of where the person is burning equal amounts of carbohydrate and fat. So you do have these extremes. You have, you know, on one extreme, people that just need to eat tons of carbohydrate in order to function fully well. And on the other extreme, people who should avoid carbohydrate at all costs and eat primarily fat in order to function well. And of course, you have people in the middle. Now, how do you know where you are on that spectrum? It's real easy. You just determine where you are right here. What does your RER have to say? That's what's going to determine it. So how do you do that? Well, years ago, I invented a process that uses something called VO2 analysis. I call this bioenergy testing. I'm going to tell you a little bit about it, then show it how it works in a second. But basically, you're going to wear something kind of like a scuba mask, and you're going to breathe through this mask. And that mask is then connected to an analyzer that's going to determine how much oxygen your body's consuming and simultaneously how much carbon dioxide you're producing. And then we can look at that ratio. And once again, if the ratio is down in the lower part, down here close to 0.7, we can say that person is burning primarily fat. And if the ratio is closer to 1, we say that person's primarily burning carbohydrate. So you can do it with this test. You can also determine the overall mitochondrial function, and that's incredibly important. Because it's your mitochondrial function that's going to determine your status as you get older. If you have really good mitochondrial function as you get into your 80s and 90s, you'll be functioning well. You won't be on any medications. You won't get any diseases. You'll pretty much do whatever you want to do. On the other hand, if your mitochondrial function is poor as you get older, you're not going to be like that. You're going to tend to have some problems. So mitochondrial function is really, really critically important. And you can use this test to determine your mitochondrial function. But it also determines your RER ratio. Tests can be done in about 30 to 40 minutes. Do it in a doctor's office. And you can find a practitioner that offers this kind of testing. I really think everybody ought to have this test, probably every 1 or 2 years, to kind of monitor how your mitochondria are doing. Because over time, your body may change from a carb burner to a fat burner. So you can find a provider here at this website, bioenergytesting.com. That's kind of what the system looks like. You can see right here, she's got this mask that she's wearing. So she's breathing in and out through that mask. It's connected with this tube to this analyzer down here. And this analyzer is analyzing in real time how much oxygen she's consuming and how much carbon dioxide she's putting out. The computer right there is recording all of this. And then we take all that data and the computer program sorts it out, and we can figure all these things out, like what the ratio is, what your maximum oxygen consumption is, and so forth and so on. So here's how you do it. A high RER, something that's close to one, with really good mitochondrial function, that combination indicates that person is a primary carb burner. They do well with diets high in complex carbohydrates. A diet that's a person has a low RER along with a good mitochondrial function, that indicates a person that's a primary fat burner. That person wants to have a diet that has a lot of fat in it. On the other hand, now, a high RER combined with poor mitochondrial function indicates typically a fat burner, a person who's a primary fat burner, who instead of eating fat like he ought to be, is eating too many carbs. That person, when you're a primary fat burner and you eat carbs, you suppress your mitochondrial function. It's astounding, but it can happen within 60 to 90 minutes. So every time, if you're a primary fat burner, every time you eat carbs, you're blowing out your mitochondria. Not a good idea for you. So it's important to know where you stand on this. And then lastly, somebody with a low RER combined at the same time with poor mitochondrial function indicates a carbohydrate, primary carbohydrate burner who, instead of eating the carbs he ought to be eating, is eating too much fat and not enough carbs. So it's pretty simple. You just find out what your RER is, you find out what your total oxygen consumption, which tells you about your mitochondrial function, is, and based upon that, in about 2 minutes, I'll tell you where you fit on that spectrum. Are you on one extreme, a pure carb burner? Or the other extreme, pure fat burner, or do you fit somewhere in the middle? And then you can make the adjustment accordingly. So let's look at the potential problems that people face. What problems do fat burners potentially face? Well, every time, as I just said, every time they eat carbs, that increases the release of the hormone insulin. One of the things insulin does is it blocks fat burning. So if you're a primary fat burner, and you eat carbs, you just blocked your method of making energy. So when fat burners eat carbs, fat burning is suppressed. What's the result? The person is fatigued, they gain weight because they can't burn fat, and more importantly, they have decreased mitochondrial function, and they're headed down the road to disease, diabetes, heart disease, cancer, weight gain, all that stuff you don't want to have. Okay, now this does not happen with carb burners. They can eat all the carbs they want. Doesn't matter, because remember, they don't burn the fat directly down in the mitochondria. They just keep converting the fat to carbohydrates through that gluconeogenesis function. So they're okay. So that's the problem with fat burners. If they eat carbohydrates, they're going to suppress their mitochondrial function and ruin their health. But here's the problem with carb burners. The body can't store carbs in any significant amount. You know, our bodies can store tons of fat. No problem there. But we can't store carbohydrates in any significant amount. And so carbohydrate burners are going to run out of energy in just a few hours. It's kind of like if you had a car and it had a one-quart gas tank. You'd have to stop the gas station all the time to fill up because you're just going to run out of energy. That's kind of like what it is for a person who's a primary carb burner. And in order for them to have enough energy and to maintain during the day, they need to be eating a lot of carbs. If they eat fat, they're just that gluconeogenesis thing doesn't work quite as fast as you'd like it to be. They need to eat plenty of carbs in order to have really, really good mitochondrial function. So for a carb burner, a diet that's not high enough in carbs will cause them to feel weak and fatigued. This especially happens in the latter part of the day when the carb stores become exhausted. So that's how you can tell if you're a primary carb burner or if you're a primary fat burner. You just do the bioenergy testing and you can figure it all out. If you're a carb burner, once again, you want to eat lots of carbs. What does that mean? It means you're the person that wants to eat fruit. You like fruit. You like the grains, the complex grains. You can have sweets without paying a giant penalty, although sweets are nutrient devoid, so you don't want to have a lot of them. You can eat root vegetables. You can eat the whole gamut, all those carbohydrates. But if you're a primary fat burner, you have to stay away from all that stuff and instead have a lot of fat. What do I mean by that? Like dairy fat, vegetable fat, olive oil, nuts, avocados, all meats, anything with fat in any kind of fat, and you'll do really well. And the other thing is, don't be happy until your mitochondrial function is optimal. Your mitochondrial function is going to determine not only how long you live, but the quality of your life, which in my mind is actually more important. I'd like to see myself get to be 90 and 100 years old and still be pretty much functional. And if I can keep my mitochondria functioning well, that's going to be the key to being that way. So get your mitochondria analyzed. You can determine, one, how well it's doing. If you're doing great, fine. If you're not, then you need to do something. And two, you can determine what's the most optimal diet for you, because for many people, that diet is really critical for mitochondrial function. And you can find practitioners that can offer this test to you at bioenergytesting.com. And I encourage every one of you to get the test initially and follow it up every 1 or 2 years. Check that test, see how you're doing. Because remember, as you get older, things start to change. So that's what I have to say today about it. I hope that helps you out a little bit to determine a little bit more on this controversy between fat and carbohydrate. And so I'll see you next time. So long.